I'm going to invite my team forward. This is part of our team. We took 12 people to Puerto Rico, and we have Nelson Thayer, who is our leader that took us. He is a retired pastor. He attends First United Methodist Church in Franklin, and he was our leader, fearless leader. If you want to come up. Also from our church, Frank Tipping and Janet Yoder. And we're going to share a little bit about our experience and the time that we have today. You may want to, if you have some questions, address them with us afterwards. But we will do our best today to give you a little glimpse of what we celebrated. We went to Puerto Rico, if you did not know, from May 17th to May 25th of this past year. And we're going to share a little bit something. Give this to you. And hopefully it's not going to speed up. So,
well, I'm supposed to click as I talk.
Right. If you want to do that, advance it, or you can tell me your answer.
I can't walk and chew gum.
Hello.
All right. Were you going to ask me a question?
How did this all start?
All right. The question was, why do we take a mission trip to Puerto Rico?
Okay.
Okay. We have worked this out, believe it or not. How did it all start? It all started with a trip that I took last year with the Bishop of Western Pennsylvania and the Bishop of Eastern Ohio. The concept was that those two bishops who had a good relationship with the Bishop of the Methodist Church of Puerto Rico, those two bishops would lead a team of about 40 people who would be trained to lead other teams. There, as you know, Puerto Rico was hit with a major hurricane, actually two of them, in 2017. And it has taken a long time for everybody to get organized. One of the things that you may or may not know about me is that I ran the Eastbrook Mission Barn. In fact, my wife and I founded the Eastbrook Mission Barn. And for about 11 years, we were involved in disaster response from the material supply perspective. In other words, we collected all the cleaning buckets, made cleaning buckets, shipped them, along with all of the other Encore kits that made me, as director of the Mission Barn, a director of a national Encore depot. So I knew a lot about what was going on in the area of missions. I knew the need. This was a disaster response situation. We were responding to a hurricane. Been trained and knew how to do all of that, and so that was the primary motivation. Going back a little further, though, we go to Puerto Rico and places like that, Louisiana, Mississippi, Florida, North Carolina, wherever there's a disaster, and this year it will be Michigan and the Detroit area had a lot of flooding, and Missouri, Oklahoma for hurricanes, tornadoes, what have you. The reason we do that these days is because we can. I remember when I was a little kid about 100 years ago, I used to be part of a local church not too awfully far from here. Mount Hope was my home church. And at Mount Hope, we would receive missionaries who would come in, and they talked to us about all these exotic places like Irian Jaya and Papua New Guinea and places like that. And they would be Bible translators and social workers and medical people. And they would come and they would tell us what a missionary does, and basically what they were doing is soliciting financial support from us so that we would, and prayer support, so that we would be partners with them in this ministry. Over the years, that has changed dramatically. We do still send, as United Methodists, we send people to be full-time missionaries in other countries. between when I was a youth and now they invented the airplane. The airplane was already invented. But travel overseas became much, much easier, more cost-effective. And so we go because we can. And today the real push for a mission is not one track. It's not sending somebody to live there permanently. But it's giving people an opportunity to go themselves. Now, there's a reason for that. One of the biggest reason is it's needed. You and I may not be professional construction people. I know I'm not. I don't know you. We may not be people who can go in and do the absolute bang-up job of rebuilding somebody's house. I doubt many of us could go in and build a road. The reality is, though, that there's a lot more damage done by a natural disaster like a hurricane than just the disaster that happens to the material possessions. And I'll let Frank and Janet talk a little bit more about how we as a team addressed that other kind of damage. But I'm the theoretician of the group. The theory is that the damage that occurs affects a person, their emotions, their psychology. It affects a community. Jeff will probably tell you about how one out of every five Puerto Ricans has relocated to the continental U.S. because of this. And it affects the spirit of the place, including the spirit of the churches. I don't know about you, but I've served over 40 years of ministry. I served a lot of churches that saw an exodus of young people to other places because that's where the jobs were. And it had a really dramatic effect on the spirit of the people. If you're losing one out of five people from your area, that has a spiritual impact. But it also has an impact when you think that you're the only ones left standing. It has an impact if you think that nobody else cares about your plight. It has an impact if you don't see people from the outside coming in and say, let me stand beside you and take your hand and let's work our way through this. The whole point of a VIM trip, Volunteers and Mission Trip, is to make those kinds of connections. I will stand beside you while you cry about what you have lost. I will work beside you to help to get you back on track for getting your life organized again. I will pray with you and sing with you in your churches as a way of helping you find again that spirit that makes it possible for you to keep going. And that's knowing that need. Having been in the situation before, I felt it was imperative that we got to put a big out. The next slide is, well, the next slide.
One of the things that we were told when we were in Puerto Rico is that after the hurricane, there were no leaves on the trees. So that's just a picture of that devastation.
This is a picture of Puerto Rico. You don't see anything in Puerto Rico up there. What you see in the green, which is to my left, that green is the Dominican Republic. Puerto Rico is underneath that cloud. You see real faintly a little dot that is centered right on Puerto Rico. And as Jeff commented when he saw this the first time, that storm is five or six times the size of the island. And that is exactly what happened. Puerto Rico was hit full force with a Category 3 hurricane. It lasted more than 24 hours. So you have sustained hurricane level winds of about 140 miles an hour for 24 hours. Most of our houses, the house you live in, the one I live in, would not manage to sustain that. There would be some damage, if not catastrophic damage. The houses in Puerto Rico, by and large, are not up to our standards. So there was catastrophic damage. devastation, as you have heard elsewhere. The need was tremendous, and probably, I'll go out on a limb here, in the 30 years that I've been involved in disaster response work, I would say this is probably the worst, including Hurricane Katrina, because of the sustained damage that was made in Puerto Rico. So why do we go to Puerto Rico? Because we can. We can be missionaries. We can take our resources, which are considerable compared to what is available in other places in the world. It's easy enough and cheap enough for us to do so. It's cost effective because, yes, they can hire more people to go and do the construction, but they can't hire people to go and talk to somebody and put your arm around them and guide them spiritually. We share, we're both Methodists, we're both Christians. We can share the hope and the love that is ours in Jesus Christ. And because the need is so overwhelming, I felt myself I had to do something. And I still think that. And if you want to go back with me in October, we're going to try.
Do you want to talk when you go back to the trip?
Okay, real quickly, these guys wanted to talk about what we did. This is the place where we stayed in Arecibo. The building, the big building in the upper right corner, that is the bunkhouse. The men stayed in the front, the women stayed in the back. It was only about half full. We occupied the bottom floor. Another team could have occupied the upper floor, but did not that week. The other building is the mess hall, the place where we gathered for a lot of our meetings. This is the team that Jeff and I were on. They subdivided our group of 12 into three separate teams of four. And the job that team was assigned to do was to replace all the floors of this house. And so we were underneath the house a lot. One of the women from Chris and Franklin and Bobby was married to a guy who is married to a guy who runs a auto body parts place, and she had never used an angle grinder, so her husband was quite impressed with the fact that we taught her how to use an angle grinder to cut metal.
And Jenna used it too.
And Jenna did too, yeah. Is Jeff looking at, well, I think you're probably putting hurricane straps on the floor joists at that point. That's me putting flooring down. Bobby and Janet working on something on the walls. I don't know what you're going to do.
I remember I was holding the wood for Bobby.
We also had to take quite a bit of water breaks. So we were, that's one of our water breaks, and we were sitting with some of the folks that were working. There was another team. I don't know if you want to talk about your wife's team and some of the things that they did.
I'm not sure. She and I don't talk. Wade and Allie are both pastors, young pastors. Wade's at First Franklin, followed by Jeff. Allie's at two churches in the Royal City area. They worked with a team. Who was on that? Bill from Midland was involved in that team, and my wife was on that team. They did a lot of doors and window cranks and things like that. She became an expert. My wife became the expert at window cranks. They also did, later on, they did some cleaning of roofs. This is a typical picture of what a team would be doing. A lot of the roofs are flat and concrete. And in order to be maintained, they need to be power washed every year and coated with a metallic-like paint. That will keep the roof impermeable so that the water flows off. Most of the people, particularly if they're elderly or poor, or both, do not do that. This was an elderly family. They had not maintained that roof. It had not been power washed for at least 5 years. So what they are doing here is taking off all the residual dirt so they can find out what's under there, whether the roof can be maintained. And the engineer, Grady, came to me afterwards and said, you know, what we discovered is that roof did not have any rebar in the concrete. And so it was very brittle. It was collapsing at points. Somebody went through the roof into the kitchen, not one of our team. But so they had a real problem. They needed to figure out what they're going to do to make that sustainable, if they can. So that was the kind of work we're doing. This is early stage work. What we were doing on the floor is later stage. But I'm going to quit talking.
That's me in a weird straw hat. My team works on roofs, but we worked on peaked metal roofs. This is the first 2 days we were there, we worked on this roof, replacing the galvanized sheeting that was on the top. And that was the view off of her roof. Puerto Rico is a beautiful country. This was across the valley, it wasn't even the valley, it was more of a chasm, to the other hillside. This is kind of an example of what Nelson mentioned. That house, the roof was completely torn off. My guess is the people that lived in that house probably left and never came back. So you see a lot of places like that 2 years later that are uninhabited, but that are basically, that they're unlivable. So that's a very common sight in Puerto Rico, is to see places like that. This was the second house we worked on. The first house was two-story. This was a single-story, simple cinder block home. That the roof was completely blown off of. A young mother and her three young daughters lived in this house. There was one room in the house that had a flat concrete roof on it. The rest of it, when the roof came off, the house was completely exposed. So they took everything they could salvage and put it in that bedroom, her bedroom, that had the concrete roof on it to try to, because it was out of the weather. Well, after they did that, that room caught on fire. So these people lost everything that they had. They live right next door to her mother-in-law. This house is right next door to her mother-in-law. They had to move up the street and move in with some friends until we could put a roof on this house. So here we are, 18 months post-hurricane, and we're finally putting a roof on this woman's house. This is what we tore off. Once we had it bare, then we replaced all the wooden trusses with C-channel, metal C-channel. So there was a lot of cutting, drilling, grinding. The guy on the left there is our contractor's name was Luis. Did not speak English, but taught construction in New Jersey. Apparently lived in a Puerto Rican community where he didn't have to speak English. But it's interesting, me having some construction background, after a couple of days, he and I began to speak what I call constructionese. I spoke English, he spoke Spanish, but we understood what we were trying to do, and oftentimes didn't even have to communicate verbally. We just I kind of knew what he was doing and what he wanted to do next. Although some of the words we use, I needed a new drill bit, and I didn't know what to say. What do you call a drill bit? And he said, drill bit. Okay, well, we don't have any problem.
Barbara, who was our interpreter. And then next to Barbara they had six or seven sons and two daughters. And they lived in Yonkers for quite a while until he retired, and then they moved back to Puerto Rico to be with their families. They were more or less displaced from their house every day during the day. They were able to have breakfast in the morning, and then they'd come out and be out all day while we worked, and then they'd go back in for their dinner, and we'd leave. But they were the nicest people. They were so patient. They were so thankful to have us there. Rosa would make coffee for us every afternoon on our break. Puerto Rican coffee with steamed milk, and she called it black sugar, but it was brown sugar, but it was granule, and it in little cups, and it was delicious. Yes, thank you. See, I only learned five Puerto Rican Spanish words to get me by, but you had a few more. We loved their coffee so much that we all went to Walmart there and bought Puerto Rican coffee to bring home. They grow 11 different kinds of coffee in Puerto Rico. And do you think we could find any around here? No, and I've looked. Maybe you looked in here. But you can get it online. But Rosa and Porfilio were so gracious. And you know, that little patio that you saw was where they were all day long. Had to go to the store or whatever, she would continually use her broom and dustpan and sweep up after the sawdust all around, front and back, to keep busy. And sometimes we'd catch them napping, sitting up like this, napping out there on their benches. They were wonderful and so hospitable to us. And I can remember the very last day when we left, Porfilio was, thank you so much, it's beautiful. I don't know if you heard that. But that trash pile you saw was way, way, way high. And it was going to be coming in the next week to cart it all off. So they were wonderful people, and we got to know them pretty well.
I just want to say a word about Rita. Third one in, Jeff, Barbara. Third one is Wheela. Wheela was our construction, on-site construction guy. And he was suffering from advanced, I understood it to be stage 4 cancer. And so every Thursday he went to get chemotherapy. The rest of the time he was on the site. And so here's this guy, he's 54, he looks like he's about 80. Really, obviously, beaten up physically, and yet he's there helping out as much as he can every day. Willow was a Puerto Rican carpenter. He would not be able to meet our American, our U.S. stateside codes, and so I had a lot to learn to fit in with what he was doing. At one point on Thursday, when he wasn't there, we had to cut a board a particular way, and I said, well, I know how I would do it, but we'll do it Willow's way. And immediately, your smart aleck pastor starts going, a week, a week, a week.
It was a good team. Some of us, like Frank was talking to me this morning just about his shirt that we're wearing, our shirts that we wore while we were there. You still have some dirt on yours, I think. Nelson brought home probably about a third of Puerto Rico in his suitcase with the dirt that he was rolling around in underneath the house. But we got to do some a lot of good things down there. One of the things that we got to do down there too is worship. And worship down there is a little bit different than it is here. One of the things that's
on a Sunday morning. One of the things is worship says it starts at 10 o'clock. We're there. As you can see, there's not a whole lot of other people there, but there was a full congregation by the time that worship started, about 20 to 11. So it's a little bit different in time. They start gathering at 10 o'clock, and they start worshiping whenever the people get there. So that's a little bit different, but we had great worship. One of the things that was interesting for me was that during the service, sometime there was about five people who came up forward and shared what God was doing in their life, and that meant a lot to that congregation. It meant a lot to us, even though we could not understand it. It was done in Spanish. We did have an interpreter speak for us while we were there. One of the things that we did too, the very first day we were there, we were all ready to work. We got there on a Saturday. Sunday, it is a non-negotiable thing with the encore. It is a day of rest. So we got there and went straight to the beach. That's us at the beach. We met some folks there, and we got to see some pelicans diving into the ocean. And it was a good, restful day. I said, if you look at anything that we put on, I said, this was a Wednesday thing. Actually, it was a Tuesday that we had a day of prayer. One of the things that is interesting that we found in the worship experiences that we were a part of down there is they focused a lot on suffering in their worship services. And they talked about finding joy in the suffering. And I'm going to look at that scripture passage that we wrote. But one of the neat things that we were able to do, too, was some of the funds that we were able to raise here is buy some tools before we left. So the last day we were there, we got done with our project at 10 o'clock in the morning. They said, you're free to go. But then we hauled cement when we got back. But between was hauling cement, we went to Home Depot and was able to buy a power washer, a grinder, a planer, and a drill for the team. Some of the funds that we raised, especially for our Swiss steak dinner that we had here. So that was a blessing to be able to do there. And we left it for further teams to be able to do. And that's just another scene in Puerto Rico. The scripture passage that they looked at throughout the time we were there, it says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. And you know, one of the things that we realized here is that we are so distracted by our comfort that we don't necessarily understand the joy of suffering. Someone who has gone through something major and tragic, such as a hurricane, can understand that a little bit better than what we can hear. And so we saw them finding joy in their suffering. And one of the things that was beautiful for me is that I was not home, but I felt like I was at home when I was with my brothers and sisters in Christ in another place, who may have not speak the language that I speak, but were able to celebrate the commonality that we have in Christ Jesus. So that was very important. You know, God brings great joy in bringing home the outcast. We see that Jesus talks about that through the parable of the prodigal son. And a father runs to restore that relationship. We see God at a work of restoration all throughout the Bible. We see that and the wanderer will be brought home, the broken will be restored. And the passage that we looked at this morning was from the book of Isaiah. And the prophet is talking to a people of a very broken land, a broken place. And it's talking about restoration here as well. If you look at verse 3 here, it says, you will be a crown of splendor in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. Again, the book of Isaiah talks about a devastated land. And in that devastation, God has made a promise that he will restore it, if you will, to the place that will be a crown, that it will once again shine. That it will once again know the height, the depth, the width of the love of God. When you look at a place like Puerto Rico, which was more devastated by the hurricane at the time that way before we got there, when we got there, we didn't see the devastation that it once.
Puerto Rico. We saw it a half, year and a half later. We know that the promise of restoration is true for that place as well. God will restore the land, and he will use us in the process of doing that restoration. You know, he used our teams and one of the things that Nelson sent to us in an email is that if you put all the hours that we worked together as a team, it was 420 hours that we were able to give Puerto Rico in volunteer hours. And we were privileged to help replace flooring, work on roofs, paint, and build relationships with those that we encounter. Again, you will be a crown of splendor in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of the God. This is a promise that we can be a part of. It really is a blessing. It was an incredible blessing for me to be part of such a work, and I pray that for everybody who was able to go. And you know, one of the things that we learned on a mission trip, and you continue to learn every time you go, is that you go to somewhat be a blessing through God's hand, but many times you're more blessed than the people that we are able to serve. You know, again, Nelson said we're going to be going back. We're looking at organizing a team here, maybe next year. But the conference is also sending back a team from Western Pennsylvania in October. Is that right?
We hope.
So if you're interested to go and be part of God's work in a different part of the world, talk to us. You know, we have a heck of a lot of work to do right here, too. We're going to be doing some of that this week with Vacation Bible School. But it is a blessing to be such a part of God's work, to be part of the restoration. You know, and we find, you know, that maybe these folks who are experiencing joy, one of the things we have to realize is that joy is a whole lot different than what we consider happiness. But joy, there is suffering. There is joy in the suffering. And there is blessing in the work. Amen. Let's have a good prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to do such a work as we were able to do in Puerto Rico. And I know that we could share a whole lot more. But we thank you for the time that we got to share today. We ask a blessing.